Hello, today I would like to talk with you about Code Playgrounds with Imper support. But before that, a little info about me. My name is Andriy and I work at JetBrains. During this time, I participated in the development of many of the company's sites. At the moment, I'm working on our new React UI library, RescueUI. Speaking of libraries, we all work with them all the time, often use their documentation. And there are definitely differences between them. But there are also similarities. So what the documentation for the UI library should look like? Definitely, there should be combined navigation, a clear components API, of course, a description of the use cases. What else? Let's pay attention to the code examples. Firstly, some developers' attention cling to such things, and their understanding of the component themselves improves. Secondly, this way you can see the use of the components in different situations. But sometimes that's not enough. You want to tinker with an example right on the spot. Try different combination of props, change the layout or the values. It seems not so difficult. There are ready-to-use libraries that supply playground components. You just put the example code into them, and the output, you get the compiled result in browser with the ability to change this code on the fly. But the problems arise when the code includes external dependencies. The most trivial situation. You want to show an example of your button with an icon, but how does the browser know exactly where to get this button and icon from? Moreover, dependencies can be of different types. Yes, six imports, CommonJS requires, as well as side effects. For example, uploading styles to a page. What can we do in such a situation? Well, a significant part of the libraries in this situation use external services for their examples, such as CodeSandbox, JS Fiddle, StackBlitz, and so on. This method has both advantages and disadvantages. The advantages include the ability to install and change dependencies directly in the browser, the ability to work with multiple files at once. Also, in case of changing the example, it is easy to share a new version. But there are also disadvantages. The inability to use these examples during local development of the library, because the changes need to be released so that the service can get them. Also, there is a relatively long loading time for each example, since each example is a separate page. Context switching between documentation and examples may be tedious. And finally, there is a need to keep the examples up to date in parallel with the documentation itself. But there is another option. For example, if the MDX format is used for the source code of the pages, then an example of a button with an icon will look like shown on the slide. In this case, the dependencies for each example need to be declared outside the code of the example itself, and then included into the previously mentioned ready-made playgrounds in the form of a scope. This method also has both advantages and disadvantages. The advantages include the ease of setting up and adding examples to the docs. Well, they in fact are part of it. It follows that there are no problems with the local development. It should also be mentioned that such examples are executed almost instantly. But, as you can guess, such a head-on solution has own drawbacks. The dependencies of the examples can be changed in browser. It is also impossible to work with multiple linked files in the browser at the same time. In addition, since the dependencies are separated from the code of the examples, they are not automatically shown in the browser for the user. As mentioned earlier, the syntax of the examples themselves is not convenient because of their separation. And finally, a special playground component needs to be called for each example, which causes boilerplate code. But what if we try to get rid of most of the disadvantages of the method, specifically related to syntax and automation? For example, a page with a playground of the button might look like this. A standard markdown syntax is used here, and the component example is a regular block of code. Dependencies are part of it. But you can't just give it to browser. It won't be able to resolve these dependencies. This means that they need to be processed at the build time. That's what I'm going to talk about today. In particular, we will parse markdown and examples, extract dependencies out of them, resolve them on build time, and then inject them into the playgrounds on the front end as a scope. But first, let's take a look at what the usual ES6 and CommonJS dependencies are in general. In fact, they consist of three components. The main component of the dependency is the source. It's usually the name of the package or file. Next, the local name of the dependency in the context of the example. And finally, the imported path. This is what's specifically taken from the model. It can be multi-level, so we represent it as an array. Well, let's go. We will work with the already familiar file with the button and icon example. Let's add the side effect import to demonstrate the algorithm. A small clarification. To build the documentation, we use Webpack 5. So all the basic logic will take place inside its loaders. Okay, as mentioned earlier, the first step is to parse Markdown using MDX.js and Remark. Remark is a Markdown parser inside the MDX.js loader. To extract dependencies, we will write a plugin for it. Inside the plugin, we go through the IST tree and look for nodes of the code type. These are our examples. To distinguish the usual static blocks with code from the playgrounds, the latter must have the JS or JS language specified. Next, we need to parse these examples and extract dependencies out of them. To parse the examples, we use Babel Parser with JS6 plugin. At the output, we get the IST3 of the example. In it, we are interested in only two tokens. Import declaration, these are ES6 imports, and call expression with require Kali name. These are CommonJS requires. Let's remember again what exactly we need to extract from each dependency: source, local name, and imported path. All right, let's start with the ES6 imports. Although there are a large number of their types, they are parsed quite simply. Source component we get immediately on the root node. Then we check the specifiers. Each of them is a dependency itself. The local name is also visibly immediately on the spot. And the imported path depends on the specifier type. If the specifiers of the import are not defined, then it is a side effect. CommonJS requires are parsed more complicated. Properties of the module and destructuring are added. However, the source component we also get from the root node. It's the argument of the require function. Everything else we collect by climbing up the IST tree. During this, the properties of the module we add to the imported path array. We move until we get to the variable declaration, or the end of the tree. On the variable declaration node, we process either destructuring or a regular constant. Not difficult, right? If, having reached the top of the IST tree, we did not stumble upon variable declaration, then this is a side effect. Now, let's take a look at how the destructuring is parsed. Yes, it's a recursion. So what we exactly do? While the given properties at each depth level have the pattern of an object, add it to the imported path array. The base case here is a property of any non-object type. It's worth noting here that because of that, one require can load multiple dependencies in an example. In addition to finding dependencies, they also need to be cut from the source code of the examples. To do this, we cut out a piece of code by the initial and final position of the node and immediately save it. Later, we need to show this raw version of dependencies to users. So let's see what we have at this stage. The first is a dependency-free source code that can be executed after some transpilation in the browser. Next is an array of the raw dependencies. And finally, the most important, dependencies itself in the format we need. The strings in such a structure are side effects for which the only source component is relevant. The most difficult part is over, and further according to the plan, the generation of requires that can be attached to the examples from the outside. For this, we use the import structure from the previous step. At this stage, we need to get two new structures from the imports, a scope object and an array of side effects. Let's take a look at how they were obtained. The elements with the local component went into the scope object, where the values of this component were transformed into the keys of the set object. The source component went into the argument of the require function, and the imported path was transformed into the properties of this function. The string-based elements were transformed into an array of side effects in the form of an argument of the require function. As you may have noticed, instead of the expressions here, we use strings with a special function name. This is necessary because the modules should be loaded not inside the remark plugin, but later, when the page is being built. At this stage, it remains only to attach all the main structures to the source node so that it gets to the frontend. In particular, we update the code of the example, add scope object, side effects array, and imports row array. We can do this by using a special slot, node, data, each properties, which will be further processed by the util inside MDX.js. These variables will fall into the props of the code block component on the frontend. This is how it will look like after running the MDX.js loader. Here are the attached props. All right, MDX.js loader with remark plugin has completed its work, and now we need to review the previously left requires in the form of strings. Recall that we left the scope and side effects in this form, and we need to bring them to this. Guess how? Yes, with the help of a loader with the regular. For clarity, the file itself looks like this before reviewing. Here are the attached scope and side effects. After transformation, it looks like this. So the requested modules now fall into the page bundle. With this, the build part is actually over. And the final part takes place on the frontend. Using MDX provider for code elements, we forward the scope object from the props into any of the available ready-made playgrounds. This step only binds the MDX component with the playgrounds from the beginning. Also, do not forget about the raw imports array to show to the user. At this point, the actual basic functionality is ready. So let's reproduce our example page with a button and an icon. This is a markdown file, and to begin with, we declare the header. Next, we declare a code block for an example. Inside the code block, we start writing the code of the example itself. Let's start by importing the button. We will not add an icon yet, just a button to start with. So we write the code for rendering, text and text inside. For a change, let's add some prop to the button. For example, size. Let's see what happened in the browser. After updating the page, the title and our playground appeared. The button works and responds to clicks. Let's try to change the text or the size. As you can see, the result is updated instantly. Adding or removing props also work. Let's complicate the example by adding an icon to our button. First, add an import of the icon itself. Next, add the icon to the button. Also, let's set the position of the icon to the left. Format the code a bit and update the button text accordingly. Return to the browser. After refreshing the page, expand the example. As you can see, the code has been updated and an icon has been added to the button. Let's try to change its position. Make it on the right. As you can see, the button responds to changes. Text updating also works. And even deleting the props of the icon altogether works. Summing up everything, the resulting playground suffered local development with hot reloading, instant execution, the possibility to use external dependencies in the source code. Also, they have a minimalistic syntax inside the markdown. Thanks to the use of such sandboxes, it became possible to easily experiment with examples in production. The development of the library itself became faster, and the documentation support became easier. As an optional extension, you can add support for TypeScript, non-standard syntax, or other dialects. The main thing here is that they must be transpilable in the browser. Unfortunately, there is no silver bullet in this matter, and this method has limitations, which we mentioned at the beginning. The inability to change dependencies in the browser, as well as the inability to work with multiple files at once. However, this is not critical for our tasks, and our users are satisfied with the resulting solution. In addition, for particularly important cases, you can also attach the previously mentioned external services in addition to code playgrounds. So, the users are happy, the team is happy, what do we need more? Thank you for your attention. Do you have any questions?